Our scripture reading this morning comes from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 17, verses 11 through 19. On the way to Jerusalem, Jesus was going through the region between Samaria and Galilee. As he entered a village, 10 lepers approached him. Keeping their distance, they called out, saying, "Jesus, Master, have mercy on us." When he saw them, he said, "Go and show yourselves to the priests." And they went, and they were made clean. Then one of them, when he saw that he was healed, turned back, praising God with a loud voice. He prostrated himself at Jesus' feet and thanked him. And he was a Samaritan. Then Jesus asked, "Were not 10 made clean? But the other 9, where are they? Was none of them found to return and give praise to God except for this foreigner?" Then he said to him, "Get up and go on your way. Your faith has made you well." May God add his blessings to our understanding of his word.
Amen. You ever wonder how long cooties have been around? And you heard me right. I said cooties, and I heard grade school over here. You know, I've heard my kids talking about cooties since the late 90s and early 2000s, back in Virginia. So clearly, they've been around since the 90s and 2000s. But I knew about cooties when I was a kid because my neighbor, my friend Veronica, educated me about the subject. More on that later. So that means cooties have been around since the early 70s. My mom and dad have been around since the 1930s, and I know they knew what cooties are. So anybody here want to confirm that they've been around for longer than that? No? George, okay, that's good.
Jesse?
Uh-huh?
I have to make something, a paper thing called a cootie catcher.
Oh, yeah.
You seen those?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. We're actually going to talk about that very thing, a cootie catcher, later on. So you're way ahead. We're good. You know, it would be interesting to see how far that concept really goes back. Because honestly, I think that concept has probably been around since the dawn of history, where people started recording history. Now I did a little research on the word, and I discovered that the word kutu comes from the Maori language, and kutu is a parasitic biting insect. So, but I don't think that's what we're talking about here. I don't think that's what most people mean when they talk about cooties. So, I guess what I'm saying is that I really don't know what cooties are, but I'm very sure I know the effective results of cooties. I know that for generations of children, they've been a clear and present danger, even though you can't see them. Here's what I know about cooties, and this is Veronica. This is Veronica educating me about cooties. Here's what I know. Let's call them cootie characteristics. Cootie characteristic number one. Cooties are highly contagious. Okay. Number two. Little boys think that only little girls have cooties. Little girls think only little boys have cooties. Mm-hmm. Characteristic number three, the presence of cooties renders one unclean. Not unlike the lepers who encountered Jesus in today's scripture lesson. I was delighted to hear from Veronica that I did not have cooties. However, she warned me that I needed to be very careful, especially with the company that I had been keeping lately. Okay? So that leads us to number four. Number four cootie characteristic is cooties are most certainly transferred by touch, but there is also a high likelihood that they are transmitted by proximity too. Number five, the most effective way to prevent cooties from being transferred then is to simply avoid touching or coming into contact with the infected, those who are infected by cooties. And it's important even to avoid contact with those who may have cooties, all right? And it's also helpful to inform others about the infected or the potentially infected so that they can avoid contact too, right? Better still, it is useful to set up rules and social contracts to make sure that the infected stay in their place. Does this sound about right? Does this sound like the rules of engagement for cooties, of those of you who know about cooties? Yeah. All right, cool. Now, I know this sounds like a silly conversation to be having in church on a Sunday morning, especially in a tradition that values education as much as we disciples value education. But I do want to blame somebody for this. He's a self-proclaimed theology nerd who has a podcast about theological issues, and his name is Trip Fuller. And Trip gives an example in one of the books he writes of what not to do when your preschooler or grade schooler asks you about cooties, okay? Because rather than just flat out telling his kids there are no such thing as cooties, like any responsible parent would, right? He goes into this big discourse about how we can achieve immunity from cooties by eating magic pretzel sticks and sharing those pretzel sticks with others, okay? Yeah, that one backfired on him in huge ways. In fact, it ended up creating a complicated matrix of weirdness that generated a whole lot more questions than it ever answered. So, when someone called him on it and asked him why he came up with this idea about magic pretzel sticks and immunity from cooties, he said, because it doesn't matter whether cooties are real or not. It doesn't matter whether cooties exist or not. The fact is, if they define the terms of engagement on the playground, then they are real. Okay? This is what happens when you let religion and philosophy majors have kids without supervision, right? But, sad to say, I actually get what he's saying. Because here's the question. Cooties may not exist, but they're real. So who makes them real? Well, the ones under the threat of contagion, of course. So how does this tie into our scripture, you might ask? You know, you're just waiting for, come on, Jesse, just tie this into the scripture. Okay, here's how it goes. When Jesus healed these 10 lepers, he tells them all to go and make themselves known to the chief priests and so that they could be made clean. So there's one leper that decides to turn around and give Jesus thanks and to say, hey, you know, I am thankful for you, gives praise to God and things like that. Anybody remember what that leper was?
A Samaritan.
Okay. So Samaritans were considered the trash by all the good, God-fearing, temple-centered Jews. Because Samaritans, they represented the country folk who remained behind after the Babylonians destroyed the temple in Jerusalem. Remember a couple of weeks ago we were talking about the exile and how It's not that they came in and took everybody and shipped them off to Babylon. They took the movers and shakers. And so there were some people who were left behind. And part of the people who were left behind were these Samaritans. And so here they are, the Samaritans. They didn't have a temple because the temple had been destroyed. And so they made adjustments to the way that they practiced their faith. So when King Cyrus of Persia conquered the Babylonians and decided to let these movers and shakers go back to Judea, to Jerusalem, guess who was on the wrong side of who's right and who's wrong? The Samaritans, those country folks that lived up in Samaria. The movers and shakers came back and said, okay, everybody, it's time to get back to business as usual. Time to go back to temple-centered worship and things like that. And the Samaritans were like, nah, we're good. We've adapted. We've learned to live without a temple because we believe that God exists everywhere. So we're fine. We don't need to go back to that. And, you know, how do you suppose that went over with the mainstream culture, mainstream Jews there? Didn't go over very well at all, I'm afraid. So the Samaritans' unwillingness to go back to this system of temple worship gave them cooties. Right? Get it? And yet, on several occasions in the Gospels, we see that not only does Jesus not care that the Samaritans were considered to be infested with cooties, he actually lifted them up as examples of people who got it, who understood what it meant to live one's faith without this temple, who they walked the walk, okay? Now, cooties, even though they don't exist, are real because they are given the power to separate, to judge, to shun. And they are used to create barriers that prevent people from enjoying all the things that life's playground has to offer. I'm sorry, but you can't play on these monkey bars. Why? Oh, well, because only people who don't have cooties can play on the monkey bars. And you, sadly, have cooties and thus cannot play on the monkey bars. Too bad, so sad, move along, go play in the dirt and leave us to our way of doing things. Well, you think, well, don't we just outgrow this notion that some people have cooties? Don't we outgrow this notion when we get older? Well, I'm not sure about that. Okay, well, do we as adults ever separate and judge and shame and shun people and prevent them from enjoying all that life has to offer? Okay, but not in the church. Well, I'm afraid history paints a much different picture than that. I'm afraid sometimes the church is the worst example of this in the history of humankind. In fact, here we go. I just want you to remember that we as the church sometimes are a bad example of insisting that cooties are real, but remember, they are real because we make them real, even though they don't exist. And here's the deal. Let's see, we know who has cooties, right? We know who to ignore. We know who to avoid. We know who to shun. And even though we leave the literal playground when we make our moves from grade school to high school, the young adulthood to adulthood, the metaphorical playground, it remains throughout our whole life. And here's where I think I actually get what Trip Fuller was trying to say to his kids when he came up with this whole magic pretzel thing that apparently messed his kids up to no end. I don't know. I can sort of get my head wrapped around what he was trying to do. Because, see, we all have cooties. Okay? We all have cooties. And they are very real. And we know it too. That's the problem, is we know it. Even though we want to act like it's all about those others who have cooties, we know that we got them too. we know what makes us different from others. You know, sometimes our cooties are about the guilt that we might bear about different things in life. Sometimes it's about secrets we hide. Maybe abuse or addiction or other things that are just kind of stored away in the little dark cubby holes of our lives. Sometimes it's about burdens that we carry that they're not of our own making, you know, family of origin things, or maybe our place on the rungs of our culture's social ladder. See, cooties can be dangerous too, especially in the ways in which we let this imagery rule over us. Here's the cure, though. We're getting back to what you were saying, Sharon. Here is the magic pretzel stick, if you will. The cure for cooties is to understand that when we enter into a relationship with God, we become new creations. And that's when we really come to the realization that cooties, real or imagined, have no power over us anymore. So some of the books that I read over the summer and sabbatical focused on Jesus' healing ministry and how it was at the very heart of almost everything Jesus said and did. So Trip Fuller, as he defended his choice not to tell his kids that cooties don't exist, called Jesus the cootie collector. Yeah. Jesus is the cootie collector because through his healing ministry, Jesus collected all the cooties from every playground across Judea, all the while proclaiming that they didn't exist, that they had no power over anybody anymore, that they were just fabrications that we human beings invented to divide us and separate us from God and from each other. So Jesus collected the cooties from these 10 lepers, as well as the sick, the prostitutes, the tax collectors, the religious leaders, the zealots, the fishermen, the kids, the rich, the poor, even his closest disciples. In fact, he managed to stir things up in so many playgrounds that the bullies who used cooties to keep the status quo and keep the people enslaved, they conspired to kill him. And they succeeded. What the bullies didn't take into account was that he would return. Right? We're people of the resurrection. We cling to that. Jesus returned. And now, instead of just one person proclaiming that cooties no longer have powers over anyone, now there were legions of people spreading this good news to everyone. Now, I sure hope that Tripp's kids remember this illustration when they grow up in their faith. And I hope that when they graduate from the playground at whatever grade school they're going to right now, that and when they graduate into the world's playground, that they understand that through God's work in Christ, the rumors, the lies, the guilt, the shame, and the fragmented parts of ourselves do not have the last word over us. The good news of Christ is that everyone has access to all that life has to offer. All means all, right? Mm-hmm.